weeks ago, that's where we start, we had a subject called bold prayers. You remember? I would be glad if you didn't, so I could repeat some things again. But if you do remember, it's okay. Bold prayers. And we didn't finish because of time. I will try to finish it today. I will do a quick review over what we did, and then we will continue wherever we stopped last time. Bold prayers. Now, yes. When we said about bold prayers, we already had the scripture reading from Hebrews 16, and the scripture reading says, "Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain grace and find obtain mercy and find grace in the time of need." We talked about our prayers compared to the Bible prayers. Our prayers, weak, wimpy, never with courage, never with confidence. "Lord, please be with us today. Guide us and protect us. And thank you so much for food and for being with me last night. Amen." Poetry prayers that we have no clue what we say. We can even think about game or even sleep while we pray. We don't need to think because we got so used to say the formula. That's not the Bible prayer. Weak prayers that we ask something. Our spouse has cancer, God forbid. And as our spouse is diagnosed with cancer, we say, "Lord, please heal him or her." But in our heart, we doubt. You know what I am talking about? We doubt. That's not the Bible prayers. In the Bible, when Jesus says, "Lazarus, come out," he said, "Thank you, I know you always answer." Lazarus, come out. Jesus was not like, would he come or not? Lazarus came out from the dead. In the Bible, there is not a shadow of doubt. It's like crazy faith. You follow me? You know what crazy faith is? You don't even think about it. You believe. It's kind of a stupid faith. You believe, but that's impossible. May the sun move 10 hours back. Come on, who would think about that? Prayers that are not weak, prayers that don't lack faith, prayers that are courageous. But we said that it's more than that. And then we talked about the story of Elijah. And we said that Elijah prayed that there will be no rain, and there was no rain for how long? 3 years and a half. And then Elijah prayed that there will be rain, and the rain came. There was not a cloud. The sky was totally clean, clear, blue, not one little cloud. Not to mention heavy rain, tornado, hurricane, pouring like under the fire hose, flooding. There was not a cloud. And Elijah prays, and then there is no noise. There is no clouds. There is no wind. And he says to the king, "Run! The storm is coming. It's going to be so bad that you will not be able to walk. Just run." And they look around and they say, that, you know, the elevator doesn't go all the way up in this guy's head. There has been no rain for 3 years and a half. There is no wind. There is not one cloud. Nevertheless, he says, "Run!" He's crazy. What type of faith? What type of prayer? He didn't get any answer. He prayed one time, no answer. He prayed second time, no answer. He prayed third time, no answer. How many times did he pray? You remember? Nah, that's wrong. It was not seven. I told you last time, seven in Hebrew has a symbol that means a perfect, a fulfilled, a complete number, as much as it takes. How many times did he pray? That's the answer. As many times as it took. Basically, prayer that doesn't give up. Like Jacob, you catch the Lord's feet and you say, "Lord, you have two options. You either kill me or answer, because I'm not going to let you go." That's prayer. Now we talk prayer. You follow me? So he basically, Elijah, prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed. And he said, "You know, get up, look." "No? Okay." What would you do if you were him when you don't get an answer? Get discouraged? He had faith. Faith doesn't depend on answers. Faith depends on relationship. If he didn't get an answer to prayer, he didn't lose his faith, because his faith was not based on getting an answer. His faith was based on knowing Christ. He knew God enough to know that he could trust God. So he kept praying. You follow me? Now, he bowed down and put his head between his knees. You remember what I said? What does it mean in Hebrew culture? Determination. Determination. He was extremely, extremely committed. He prayed with intensity. But Elijah was not Superman or Spider-Man. And he was not even Rambo or Schwarzenegger. Elijah, he was a man just like you and like me. Okay? But he prayed how? And that in Greek, it's proseumai proseuche. It's not earnestly. He didn't pray earnestly. He prayed the real deal. That's the way you translate. He prayed the prayer. He prayed the prayer. Church, how do we pray the prayer? The Greek bold means speaking openly. Great freedom in speaking, speaking with confidence, speaking with courage, without ambiguity, with joy and assurance. That's the translation in Greek. Opening the heart to God as to a friend, not using some formulas, not using some formulas. And we have one more thing and we finish the review. The same, the disciples, they go and preach, and after they go and preach, what happens? They get beaten, Peter and John, and they go with broken clothing and blue eyes and blood all over. Now, if somebody beat you, how would you feel about it? You don't know? Come here and I'm going to show you. No? No, I don't do that. I just joke. Okay. If somebody beat you, how would you feel about it? I want you to be honest. If somebody beat you and they threatened you, what would you pray for? You follow me? And what they do? Very simple. Lord, you see what they do? Please do justice, protect us. That's what they pray? Help us continue to preach with boldness. Okay, this is where we stopped last time. Church, that's the way you pray. And we decided that this year for the Lexington Church will be the year of prayer. And we decided that we will see prayer groups that you start at home. Small, that's the key. Don't look for 20 people. Look for 3 or 4. Small groups so people could open and you could pray for one another and see answers. Okay, small groups. And we decided that on the hallway when you meet people, instead of talking about how you cooked that dish, you pray together, okay? And we decided that this house will be a house of prayer. That will be like the disciples, people devoted to prayer. Okay, what happened when the disciples prayed? This is where we dropped it last time. This is where we start today. What happened when they prayed that type of bold prayer? The place shook, earthquake, physically. After that, they went out and spoke boldly. Do you remember the story? Thousands. How many thousands? Thousands. 5,000 got baptized. And miracles were performed. And then the next verse says that they would bring the sick to the disciples. And the disciples would pray over them and the sick were healed. Imagine here, literally, people from Lexington bringing the sick here instead of hospital. And then it says that even Peter's, you remember? Shadow would go over sick and the sick would be healed. You remember that? We talk about power, church. Not Peter's power. So what happened? What type of prayer did they pray? And this is, church, where you need to pay attention. Principle number one that we find in Elijah's prayer, in Peter's prayer, in Daniel's prayer, in all the Bible prayers that you can get, if you put all the Bible's prayers together, they focus on God. In our prayers, we focus on self. Bless me, heal me, forgive me, help me, my wife, my husband, my children, my job, me. Save me, forgive me, give me. It's all about me, self-centered society, a society of consumerism. I need this and I need that and I need it now. In the Bible, it's nothing about them. Paul prays for them. But if you look in Ephesians, Jay said very nice in the Sabbath school, he doesn't pray for their jobs or for their health. He prays for the spiritual state. He prays that they do ministry. Church, could it be that we don't get answers because we are too self-centered? Could it be that our prayers go in the wrong direction? And you may think that you do the right thing, but we actually don't. What if we changed our prayer requests and give up self for once and just pray for what God wants us to pray instead of praying for what we want to pray? We focus on God in prayer. You got to remember, when you go there, you enter into the presence of God. As you go there and as you enter into the presence of God, pay attention who you are talking to. You see, they say, Sovereign Lord, you are God. You have made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them. Remember, the Lord's Prayer starts that way. Our Father who are in heaven, hallowed be thy name. What does Jesus do in the Lord's Prayer in the beginning? You focus on God. You remember, you enter into the Trinity room. You enter into the grace room. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit are there. And the elders are there. And the beings are there. You remember? And the angels are there. And as you enter, you, Father in heaven, thank you for being with me last night. Be with me today. Would you please protect me? Amen. And you leave. That must not be in God's presence. Because if you enter into God's presence, you behave different. Remember, when you pray, you enter into the Trinity holy place. Angels sing, holy, 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 the Lord God Almighty. When you enter there, you better be quiet and contemplate God than keep asking things. God knows what you need. God doesn't need to be informed. Oh, by the way, Lord, you may not know. This is what I need, and this is how you should fix it. Oh, God doesn't know. Focus on God. Pay attention who you are talking to. Contemplate Him. Think about His grace. Usually we focus on our needs instead of focusing on God. Before the throne of the Creator, you should actually contemplate His character. Angels are amazed. They say, He came into God's presence and He is living right away. You focus on God. I remember when I was talking to my dad and I said, I got problems at work because of Sabbath and I am praying and God doesn't answer. My dad said, you prayed the wrong prayer, son. I said, what are you talking about? You pray for job. God knows your needs. You don't need to ask Him to love you. He already loves you. He paid on the cross. You should focus on God. And I said, I am. He said, no, you are not. He said, the reason you ask for a job is because you don't trust God. If you knew God enough, you would know that God is love. You would know that God knows. And you would trust Him. And you would feel no need to pray for your job. You would rather praise Him for who He is. And you would choose to trust Him. You follow me, church? When you enter into God's presence, focus on God. Principle number two, the disciples focus on God's word, who by the mouth of your servant David had said, quoting from Psalm 2. How in the world did they know Psalm 2? By memory. That tells me that they were reading the scriptures. They were not just reading the scriptures, they were memorizing the scriptures. How many of us memorize, not just read? Well, many times we forget the good habit to even read the scriptures. We used to be called students of Bible. How many of us, and don't answer, wake up early every morning and pray and study the word? That's life. That's where the power is. That's what God uses to grow us spiritually, to help us know Him. You search the scriptures because you think they in them is eternal life. But they testify about me, reading and studying and praying over the scripture in order to know Christ, because to know him is life eternal. Focus on God's word. Memorize God's word. Instead of focusing on the problems, focus on promises. Read God's word back to him in prayer. Did you hear what I said? Read God's word back to him. That's what they do. Do you see the disciples, when they pray, they actually read Psalm 2 back to God. But they don't read. They memorize enough to be able to recite it, to say it. Focus on God's word. Instead of focusing on self, you focus on God. Instead of focusing on problems, you focus on promises. You remember a few Sabbaths ago, I had Nathan here. And when he said, I was struggling, and he called me, what did I tell him to do? To praise the Lord instead of asking the Lord. And number two, to look for how many? Nathan knows, you don't remember. 10 Bible promises. And read them back to God in prayer. Read them back to God in prayer. And then call somebody else and help somebody else. And he said he did that, and he was blessed right away. Reading scriptures back to God. We don't do that in prayer, do we? That's what the disciples did. By the way, this is Psalm 2. This is what it says. He who sits in heaven laughs. The Lord scoffs at them. He rebukes them. And then he says, I have installed my king on Zion. Who is his king? God the Father is talking about God the Son. And then he says, you are my son. Today I have become your father. In Hebrew it says, today you became a son. Basically Jesus, who is eternal, when he took human nature, he became a son. You follow me? But now listen carefully what he says next. Ask me and I'll give you nations. You know what it says in Hebrew there, instead of ask me. In Hebrew it's translated this very way. I'm gonna invent something. The father and the son have a meeting and they have a conversation. And the father says to the son, we decided together in the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that you will go and take human flesh and you will be human and you will die to pay for them, to save them. Son, I want you to know, in that day when you become a son with human nature, you cannot use your divine power. You will have to ask. You follow me? That's a translation in Hebrew. Pray to me. You will have to ask me in order to receive. And you'll receive whatever you ask. Jesus had to pray. Jesus would spend whole nights in prayer. Jesus had to ask. He didn't use his divine power. All that he did because of prayer. Church, if Jesus prayed, don't you think that we need to pray? So, prayer focuses on God and his love and his sacrifice and his word and his honor and his will, his plan. Again, focus on God's word. Quote God's word back to him. Read promises. Jesus prayed that way. The disciples prayed that way. Daniel prayed that way. Throughout the Bible, all of them focused on God's word. As you read God's word and promises back to him, it would give you strength and peace and faith. It would help you know God enough to trust him. Just then, you are safe to ask. Before you focus on promises, you are not safe to ask anything. Let's move on to the next one. Pray God's will. That's kind of difficult. It says, pray God's will. This is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. Listen, you know what anything means in Greek? If we ask anything in Greek, you know what anything means? Any clue? Anybody? I tell you what it means. Anything. Just like in English. I checked it and there is no second translation. There is no second word. There is no second interpretation. I said, oops, this is a simple one. Anything means anything. So let me ask you what anything means to you. if you ask anything, bold prayers means that you have the courage to ask anything. You know, we pray very little because we don't trust Him. And we don't trust Him because we don't know Him. And we don't know Him because we don't spend time with Him in prayer and study of the Word. They are so much connected. If you know Him, you feel free to go into His presence and ask anything. Jesus says, you have just a little faith. You can move mountains. You can pray to the sea and the sea would split. You can pray to the sun and the sun would move. You can do anything. If you have just a little faith and you pray bold prayers, you can pray to the dead and they come back to life. You don't just give a sermon over the dead. You can pray to the sick and they are healed. Jesus told them, miracles would accompany you. Where are those miracles? Those who surrender 100%, they can ask anything and they receive what they ask. Isn't that something? That's bold prayer. We need to learn that, church. But it is more than that. I want you to hear what it says next. If we ask anything according to... Oh, this is where people become kind of... they deflate. Oops. You know, according to His will, not my will. Because often we assume that this is a good plan, a plan that we make, and we ask God to bless it. That's presumption, church. The sin of presumption. Our plans are as far from God's plans as heaven from earth. The best of them. That's our plans. You cannot go with your plan and ask God to bless it. God blesses the plans that He makes, not the plans that we make. If it is God's plan, it has God's blessing and God's power and God's resources. If it's your plan, it has your blessing and your power and your resources. Therefore, we make plans, pray for them, and then we go ahead and do it ourselves. If God made a plan and you pray for it, then guess what? God will do it. Why do we feel the need to do it? Because it's our plan. Think about Elijah. Did he make the plan? No more. Oh, I thought about something. No more rain. And then it rains 3.5 years. That's a nice number. God met him. And God told him, go to the king, to Ahab, and tell him there will be no rain. You remember? God gave him the plan. He didn't just pray, let Lord be no rain. Oh, now let be rain. God told him, now you gather them. Now you pray for rain. He just obeyed God. Church, we cannot afford to make plans. We should rather pray for God's plan. Therefore, we need to pray. Listen, I did say it to you before. Pray for what to pray before you pray for what you pray. Yes, pray for what to pray. Make sure that you align your prayers with God's will, God's plan. Then you can expect answers. In order to pray for God's will, we need to want God's will. Jesus did that in the garden. Take the cup from me. Nevertheless, may your will. Pray for God's will. Pray for God's plan. You remember I told you, for instance, about John in Flint, Michigan. John in Flint, Michigan. He told me, I pray and I get no answers. And I said, John, that's because you pray your needs instead of praying God's plans and needs. And I said, take care of God and He will take care of you. He said, what do you mean? God doesn't need me to take care of Him. I said, yes, He does. He would not have asked you to do something if He didn't need you to do it. Very, very disturbing. Often we ask God to do what He asked us to do. Lord, may the gospel be preached in Lexington. God asked me and you to preach the gospel in Lexington. Lord, take care of the poor. God asked you and me to take care of the poor. We should rather say, Lord, I am going to go to this house or to my neighbor to do what you told me to do. Be with me. That's the way you say, Lord, take care of the gospel. You follow me? Lord, I go to obey you. Be with me. And John in Flint, Michigan, he says, what do you mean? And I said, very simple, this is what I mean. In the morning when you pray, ask God for his plan for today. For I know the plans that I have for you. And that's a present continue. God, not just the plan of salvation. God has a plan for you every day. And in order to know God's plan, you got to be willing to know God's plan. And in order to find God's plan when you pray, you got to listen. And we never listen. We just talk and go. You got to listen. How do we listen in prayer? So I told him, make yourself available. Lord, here I am. I make myself available today. Would you please show me your plan? Would you use me today? I'm willing to do that. And I told him, forget self. He knows you. He knows your needs. I told him, he knows you when you take a shower. He knows everything about you. And he said, okay, so I don't pray for me. I pray for his plan. Yes. He said, what about my job? I said, forget your job. Come on, man. He said, but I do need to pray for my job. I own a business and we didn't get an order for the last 6 months. I said, well, God may not know. He may be asleep. Let's tell him that. He doesn't know. Like the prophets of Baal. You got to scream. Baal is asleep. He's in vacation. He's in Hawaii. He doesn't hear you. I said, that's what you mean? He said, no, I know God knows. Then what's the problem? You don't trust him? Then why do you pray? No, I trust him. Then what's the problem? He said, aren't we supposed to tell him our cares, our needs? I said, no, we are supposed to throw them, not to show them. It says ekbalo. That means throw your needs upon him, and the translation means so far that you cannot reach them and take them back. Throw them upon the Lord, leave them there, and move on. Focus on God, don't focus on problems. I said, man, did you tell God about your job and gave him permission to work? Yes. Then move on. When the time comes, he will work. Don't feel the need to help the Lord because the Lord doesn't need your help. Move on. You get involved, you make a mess. Move on. Choose, elect to trust him. He said, that's hard. I said, yeah, because you don't trust God. The same problem. Now he said, then what should I pray for? Make yourself available and then listen and then study and then listen and then pray and then listen and then study and then listen. He said, oh, that's difficult. I said, no, that's easy. It doesn't cost you a penny. It would be difficult if I ask you $1,000, but I don't. He smiled. I'll do that. You promise me? Yes. He did it. He called me a week later. It's amazing. God answers. He said, duh. The whole Bible says that God answers. This is first time when you know. How long have you been an Adventist? 38 years. Ooh. God answers after 38 years. And I said, okay, tell me, what did he say? Nothing. Okay, tell me more then. How did he answer? He says, I said, Lord, I want to forget self. And I want to fulfill your plan for today. So what did you do? He said, nothing. I said, I'm listening. And God didn't speak. So I got into my car and I was driving to work. Michigan, when you say Michigan, you say snow. They go together forever. Mountains of snow. Crazy. Whatever. So he was driving on snow on Interstate 90 or 94. I don't remember. Doesn't matter. 94, I think. He was driving on snow through the interstate and the snow kept pouring day and night for 2 days. And in that morning when he was driving, he says the truck would go to clean the road. 10 minutes later, the snow would be back. Crazy. My son Gabriel knows about that. Don't you love snow, son? Yeah, I know how much. I know. I believe you. Yeah, driving on snow. And as he's driving on snow, he and his wife talk. He's in his Suburban and he talks to his wife and he says, honey, I'm not going to turn the news or music on. I'm going to listen if God talks to me, if God tells me what to do today. He says, okay. He doesn't turn the music on. He's listening to God. He's praying and listening, asking for God's will. And God impresses him to look right. And he looks right and his wife is there. And he says, yeah, honey, you are beautiful. And he says, what? And as he looks to her, he sees something in the snow by the road. And he says, honey, I saw something white on the snow. And she says, honey, snow is white. If you don't know. He said, no, something else white on the white. She says, you didn't eat enough food today. You may, he said, no, I know what I saw. That's God talking to me. I was praying for it. So he goes to no U-turn, don't do that. He turns around on no U-turn, on the interstate, he goes back to the previous exit, 2 miles. He comes back and he drives slow and he sees an old man in a white robe, in snow. And he stops the car. He puts the... And then he goes there and the man has something here, a band that says his name and says Alzheimer's. Obviously, the man left hospital to go home and he forgot where home is and he froze. So he takes the man in the car in his nice Suburban and they run to the closest hospital. When they get there, the doctor says 30 seconds to 1 minute, he would have been dead, would have been way too late. We'll try to resurrect him, we don't know. And they bring him back and he is frozen and they work on him. Kind of, I don't know how long. Meanwhile, the daughter comes and says, how did you see him on the snow? He says, well, that's a long story. Tell me. Well, the pastor has talked to me and I was praying that God would show me his plan. And God told me, look right. And I looked right and I see my wife. And then I keep looking and I see something on the snow. And I feel that God is talking to me. And I turn around and so on and so forth. And she says, what church do you go to? He said, well, the Seventh-day Adventist church here in Flint. That's what I want to join. And he said, well, but we don't eat pork. I don't care. But we keep Sabbath. I don't care. You can keep Tuesday. I don't care. God is there. God talks to you. That's what I want. Church, do you follow God's will? Don't pray your will and ask God to bless it. You'll never get a blessing. Seek God's will. The Holy Spirit makes intercession because we don't know in Greek what to ask. So the Holy Spirit has to change our prayers because we ask the wrong things. Pray what to pray before you pray what you pray. You follow me? I hope you do. Next. The Holy Spirit teaches us what to pray. The Holy Spirit. We should seek first God's plan and then our plans. God's kingdom before my kingdom. Align your prayer with God's will. That takes surrender, church. Listen, takes surrender. In order to give up your will, that takes surrender, daily surrender. Principle number 4, pray boldly. What was number 1? Focus on God. You enter God's presence. Number 2, focus on God's word. Number 3, God's will. Thank you. You see who listens? God's will. Number 4, that's easy. You can see it. Pray boldly. Pray openly, with courage, with confidence. Courage to be open. Courage to ask anything. Courage to sacrifice self. Courage to persist in prayer, not to just give up. Listen, I told you a story that I know. I told you like a couple of times, but I cannot help tell you again. The lady that was in one of my districts, that she had a holy voice and a regular voice. You remember? When she would pray, she would put on the holy voice. Oh, Lord, don't do that. Pray openly. Pray who you are. Don't pick funny, nice words that nobody understands what you say, but you can impress them. Open heart. You don't have to impress the Lord. You cannot impress the Lord except if you love him with all your heart. Let the Lord impress you. When you try to impress the Lord, you pray to people. When you open your heart, then you pray to God. You follow me? Pray openly. Pray openly. What happened here? No, we got wrong. Okay. Now, what does it mean to pray bold? It means to be open. It means to have courage, to have confidence and joy and peace. It means also to have the courage to give up self. Listen, church. What do they pray for? Do they pray, Lord, protect us? Or they say, I don't care what happens to me. They may kill us. Help us to keep preaching the word. Elijah, he could have died. Paul says, they tell him, don't go to Rome, you'll be killed. And Paul says, okay, thank you so much, I will not go to Rome, I go home. What does he say? Paul goes there. If I live, I'll work for Christ. If I die, I'll see Christ. Either way, it's a gain. I don't care. I'm not important. What if we surrender to the point that when we pray, we forget self and we say, me, my problems, and I know you have problems, my needs, my family, my health, my job, not important. God's plan, more important. And instead of praying for those small things, We see the big picture and we pray for the big things and we have the boldness to give up, sacrifice, self, die to self. Those prayers get answer. You take care of God, God will take care of you. Those prayers get answer. I remember when they told my dad, you stop building churches, you stop bringing Bibles. And you know the story, you have read my book, you heard the story before. And he said, I cannot, I got to do what God asked me to do. We'll kill you. He said, well, that's not a big problem. Because my life belongs to God. If he wants it gone, I die. If he wants me to live, you can kill me. Still, I'm going to be alive after. We'll take everything you have. Well, I don't own anything. I gave it to the church. You cannot take it from me. They said, wait, wait. And they got the gun and they put it in his chest. We can shoot you right now. And he said, hold on a second. He unbuttoned his shirt. Now you can shoot. Why do you do that? Well, there are poor people who don't have a shirt. Don't stain it. Give it to somebody. They said, you are crazy. He said, well, Christians are foolish for this world. But that's the wisdom of God. And they said, we cannot talk to this guy. He's crazy. He said, well, shouldn't we die to self and live for God? I don't have a problem if you kill me for God. That's an honor. And they scratched their head and they called the mayor. Called the chief of police. What should we do with him? Beat him. He's not afraid. Call the mayor. Kill him. Okay. And you remember the story. It was 4:30 p.m. The mayor got in his car with his driver. And as they left the city hall, next block, a truck hit and killed the mayor. That very day, that very hour. You know the story. So the guy who survived, the driver, called the city hall and talked to the police officer who was supposed to kill Dad and said, let him go home. He says, I need to have orders. So they called the vice president of the city, the one who was under the mayor. What should I do with him? He says, well, I want to stay alive. Let him go home. I have a family. But my father was ready to die. Ready to die. He said, what do I lose? I see Jesus. Church, can it be that we have a short vision, horse vision? You know what I mean? We are so concerned with 2 years of life. Instead of thinking eternity and just trust God on those 2 years, choose to trust the Lord. Can it be? Those prayers get an answer. Pray boldly. Now, church, we do 2 more things and we stop and we'll continue in a different time because the last one is way too important. So, pray big prayers. Big prayers, we already talked about it. It's not our Father in heaven, be with us today, and then we ask small things, and then we go ahead and do it. Big prayers mean things that are impossible. Don't pray human things. Pray godly things. Pray godly things. Peter didn't pray that Dorcas would have a nice funeral. People said, everybody out, Lord, bring her back. Elijah didn't pray that the son of the widow, that she would get pregnant and she would have another son. Elijah said, get out. He got over the body and he said, Lord, I'm not going to give up before you bring him back. What would be if our church prayed that type of prayers? We pray small prayers that offend God. That talks about what type of God we have. Our God is not a weak God. Why would we pray weak prayers? I tell you why. Because we don't know God enough to trust him. Now remember, according to his will, and you know what his will, when you pray in his name, in Hebrew, doesn't mean to say, in Jesus' name, amen. That's a formula, abracadabra. In Hebrew, in his name means according to his character. That's the way you translate it. Name in Hebrew means character. When somebody would change his character, they would give him a new name. When you pray in his name, you pray according to his character. You make sure that you are according to his will. Church, if you pray according to his will, you can ask anything. Anything. When you pray according to his character, signs and miracles would accompany you. No problem. I want you to remember. When they started the work, they performed miracles. The Bible says that we will do greater things. When we will close the work, we will perform miracles. Those will happen to people who pray. I got to finish, so I got just to move on. Most miracles in the Bible are to advance God's work, not to help people in need. Even when Jesus would help them, it was that they would know God and they would be saved. Most prayers, when we ask for a miracle, are to help us in need, instead of being, they are self-centered, instead of being to advance God's work. Pray big prayers like Joshua. Pray big prayers like Moses. Pray big prayers. I'm going to do one more. You'll receive power and you'll move mountains and you'll do greater things and miracles will accompany you and the world will close with greater power. Big prayers. The last one that we do today, pray in faith. For without faith, it's impossible to please God. You remember I told you about my son Ovi? Dad, can I have a motorcycle? I'm going to buy the toy for you tomorrow. Hey, I got a motorcycle! Thank you! Running outside. Crazy faith. You cannot receive before you trust. You are not safe to ask before you know him to trust him. Expect results when you pray. Have positive view. Positive view is based on relationship. People who know Christ says steps to Christ. People who know Christ, they trust him and have faith in him even when they don't understand. Don't look for an explanation. Look for Christ. Church, we are going to stop here. I want to, the next one would be pray for the Holy Spirit. And the last one, I'm going to stop right there. So the next one will be pray for the Holy Spirit. But listen carefully. When we pray for the Holy Spirit, when we pray in faith, when we pray with courage, when we pray big prayers, the Holy Spirit doesn't come because we need something else. We have house, we have car, we have TV, we have church, we have music, we have sermon, and we need something else. We need the Holy Spirit. We need power. The Holy Spirit doesn't come because we need something else. Every time in the Bible, when the Holy Spirit is poured, is given for ministry, to enable the saints to do ministry. What is the Holy Spirit given for? For ministry. The Holy Spirit is given for ministry, church, for ministry. The Holy Spirit is given for ministry. Listen carefully. The Holy Spirit convicts you, and that's the work in the individual for repentance, and the Holy Spirit, that's the word for the individual. And the Holy Spirit is poured over a group, not over an individual, to do ministry. I want you to watch this. Every time when we talk about the Holy Spirit, it says, he commanded them to wait and pray until they receive the Holy Spirit. And then they receive power. The power comes when? When the Holy Spirit comes. And then what do they do next? Witness. In Greek, it says you receive, pray, wait, you receive the Holy Spirit. Then you receive power. Therefore, you will go and will witness for me. That's the Greek. When you receive the Holy Spirit, you witness. Listen what happens. You pray and wait. You receive the Holy Spirit. You receive power. You witness miracles, baptisms. The early rain was the outpouring of the Holy Spirit over the church so they could start the work. They preached, miracles happened, great results. The latter rain is the outpouring of the Holy Spirit so we could finish the work. We will preach, miracles will happen, great results. You follow? To everyone who offered himself to God, withholding nothing. For what? For service. Is given unlimited heavenly power for the attainment of measureless results. All that the disciples did, the church members should do today. A work similar to one that they did is going to happen again. If Jesus prayed, if Elijah prayed, if the disciples prayed, don't you think that more than life, we need prayer? When we pray not because we want the Holy Spirit, but because we want to finish the work. That's the reason the Holy Spirit is given. Not because we need power. The reason is that we could finish the work. When we pray for that, the Holy Spirit will be pulled. What you'll do next? You'll preach. What would happen next? Power. Miracles. Things. Unbelievable things. Thousands will be baptized. Sick will be healed. Dead will be resurrected. It will happen again here. The church will not be enough. We'll need to build 20 churches in Lexington. Tens of thousands will get baptized. It will happen, church. When we pray the real prayer. So, church, what if we, as we make it the year of prayer, as you all start praying, what if we have the courage, the boldness to stop praying for ourselves and start praying for ministry? We'll see answers here. I prayed about something that we also can do easily. And God, I was praying. I finished prayer. And Judy called me. Actually, she sent me an email. And I prayed over it. And I sensed that it is God talking to me. So I prepared something for you. A letter, very simple, nice letter. And a book. It's not for you. Don't take it if you take it for you. It's not for you. It is that if you have somebody that you took a card like this, and you put on the back the names, if you pray for those people, or somebody that you have in your heart that you pray for, a family member, somebody who left the church, a co-worker, a friend, a neighbor, somebody that God put in your heart, as you pray for them, we prepared a letter and a nice book. It's a Steps to Christ that in the back has a very nice Bible study. We give you the book. It's not for you. What you do, you give it to them, okay? And you don't say anything except, hey, God inspired me to give you this book. And I want to invite you to the Easter program. And in the letter, it actually invites them to come on April 12th when we have communion. Basically, it'll be a very, 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 very short sermon. We talk about a meditation of about 3 to 5 minutes. No sermon, and it will be a lot of music, and it will be 2 skits that the children would play based on the sacrifice and communion, and invite people, come on April 12th, we celebrate Jesus' death and resurrection. Come, come and see, and give them the book and the letter. If you want a book and the letter, they are ready for you right now. Hands up, and we'll give you the books and the letters. Hands up. But if you have somebody that the Lord put in your heart, then take a book and a letter for that somebody and give it to them and pray that God would work with their heart. Let's have a closing prayer. Father in heaven, as we come into your presence, we pray that you will make us a praying church. We ask that your Spirit may work in our hearts to help us know you and have a relationship with you and learn to trust you and make you the priority, the center of our life, not self. That we learn to pray bold prayers just like Jesus, just like the disciples, just like Elijah, just like Moses, just like Noah, like Daniel, to pray bold prayers, prayers that get answers, that place would be shaken, miracles would happen, people would be saved. And then you will come again. Father, may this church become a house of prayer. We ask your help. We pray over these books that we just gave. May the people who receive them get to know you and be saved. We pray these things in Jesus' precious name. And we know that you answer because this is according to your will, Father. We praise you. Amen.